Welcome to day four of The Wait Is Over. Monday we talked, excuse me, Monday we talked about the W, which was what, when, why, and how we eat, or how to eat. And then Tuesday was the E of wait, and we talked about getting your energy back. Yesterday was the I, where we talked about the inner work and mindset. And today is G. God is at the center. And it still is a little bit about mindset. No, it's a lot about mindset. Let's just face it. But God is at the center. Actually, let me just quickly check on my phone here. I want to make sure that the video is live and that I can see your comments. So while I'm chatting and looking here, there we go. All right, we're good. Okay. So for today, hi, Shirley. I knew you were the one that was on. I can always count on you to be here. Okay, so today's verse, the first verse that we have for today is John 6:35. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry again. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Now, I know that it's not talking about real hunger and real thirst, because obviously we're going to be hungry and thirsty. We need food and water in order to live, right? But just think about that. God is the bread of life. So whatever we need, he's going to give it to us. Let me just go a little further here. Matthew 5, verse 6 says, God blesses those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be satisfied. So again, it's talking about the hunger and the thirst. And if we're hungering and thirsting for righteousness, then we're going to be satisfied. God is going to satisfy us, right? Matthew 4, verse 4 says, people cannot live on bread alone, but need every word that God speaks. So what happens is, a lot of times when we feel like we need something, we turn to food, right? Go to the cupboard, like something's just not feeling right. You feel like you need to be filled. And so you go and you reach in the cupboard, the fridge, wherever, you reach for the food and drink in order to fill your body. Here's the thing. What you're really wanting, if you're not hungry, but it's something else, probably what you're wanting is not to be filled with food, but to be fulfilled by God. God will fill us and satisfy us. And sometimes we turn to food for comfort, right? We all have those comfort foods that we turn to. So tell me in the comments, whether you're watching live now or whether you're watching the replay, let me know, what is your favorite comfort food? Mine is a bag of chips with a container of dip, like the entire bag and the entire container. It's been a long time since I've been able to do that, like to do the entire bag and the entire container. But doesn't the Bible tell us that the Holy Spirit, that Jesus sent the Holy Spirit to be our comforter? So instead of turning to food for comfort, turn to the Holy Spirit for comfort. Instead of turning to food to fill whatever it is that feels empty, instead, what would change if you turn to God? Shirley says popcorn. And you know what? Popcorn's not bad. What's bad is all the stuff, the butter that you excuse me, that you add to the popcorn. I love popcorn with gobs and gobs of butter. My friend says goo gobs. Gobs of butter on it. Then I love it. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 31 says, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. For the glory of God. So it's not glorifying to God if I'm feeling empty and I'm feeling void of something and I'm maybe emotional and I need some comfort. And instead of turning to God, I turn to food. That doesn't really glorify him, right? Because it's not, God can't perform the miracles in us eating the junk food, but he can perform miracles and do amazing things in our lives if we allow him to. So if you were eating for the glory of God, how would that change the way you eat? Hey, Tabitha, thanks for being here. If you were eating and drinking for the glory of God, how would that change the way that you eat? That's a tough one. You know what? And let me just be clear on this. There is nothing wrong with having junk food, with having the desserts and having the junk food, or having those foods that feel like an indulgence. There's nothing wrong with having those foods. The problem is when it becomes too much, when we overeat, when we binge. That's where the problem is. The small amounts in moderation, not a problem. You can have chips. You can have cake. You know what? On Thursdays, we go to our local butcher to pick up. We buy our dog food there, and they have a local woman that makes these amazing peanut butter cups. And so on Thursdays, we go get the dog food and we buy a peanut butter cup. There's nothing wrong with having that once in a while. I have that treat once a week. We don't go buy 10 of them and come home and eat all of them. That is where the problem lies. It's in the indulgence, in the extremes. But moderation, there's nothing wrong with that. All right, where am I? Psalm 107, verse 9. He satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things. So again, it's talking about being satisfied, that God is satisfying that hunger and that thirst, not the actual physical hunger and thirst, but that spiritual hunger and thirst, that when there's something missing and you know you can't put your finger on it, maybe it's God that's lacking. Maybe that's what's missing. Had an ice cream sandwich today with no guilt. Absolutely. I bought some of those last week and we had a couple of them. Not all in the same day, but throughout the week, we had a couple. Shared them with the grandkids. My daughter had some. So having that once in a while is not a big deal. It's when we go to the extreme that then there's something wrong. There's something that needs to be changed. And we'll talk about that in a little bit. So when you feel like something's missing and you feel empty, fill that void with God and not with food. Colossians 3:17 says, whatever you do or say, do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus. Now, we've talked about what we're doing and doing that as unto God, but I want to talk right now about the things that we say. And we touched on that a little bit yesterday, and surely you were triggered by that when I said, pretended that I had stepped on the scale and that the scale went up and that my best friend told me that I was a loser, a fat, stupid, ugly, that I would never amount to anything. She told me I was a cow, that I was a failure, and just give up because you aren't worth it anyways. And my friend would never tell me that. But we tell ourselves that. We do that to ourselves. We put ourselves down. And if you heard somebody else put me down that way, you would be like, oh my gosh, like Shirley was upset at that person for saying those horrible things to me. But we say those things to ourselves and we think it's okay. So whatever you say, do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus. Is that the way God's going to talk to us? God thinks that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. I talked about that yesterday, that he says we are radiant. We are clothed with dignity. I forget the other verse, but we're worth far more than rubies. So does that match the way I was talking to myself? It doesn't, right? So whatever you say, do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus. Talk to yourself the way God would talk to you. And it may be hard in the beginning, but the more you do it, then the easier it's going to be. It's going to take some time. I have worked with some clients who had really struggled with their self-esteem. And so in the beginning, when we started working on building their self-esteem and the way that they talk to themselves, it was very, very difficult for them to be able to change that. But once it's like one day it just clicks, and then you're like, oh, all of a sudden you realize, I'm feeling so much happier. I'm feeling so much better about myself. When did this happen? Like, it just clicks. It's happened to me, and I've watched it happen to multiple clients that I work with. They'll just come to me and say, I don't know what's going on. I just feel so happy these days. That's what it is. When you start changing those negative thoughts into positive thoughts, when you start putting God at the center, you feel so much happier. Proverbs 3 verse 5 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Don't rely on what you think you know. And verse 6 says, remember the Lord in everything you do, and he will show you the right way. So trust the Lord with all your heart. Don't rely on what you think you know. Sometimes when you're starting a plan or you're thinking of starting a plan, it would be helpful for you to pray about it first and say, okay, God, where is it that you want me to go? This is where I was at in September of 2018. I was at my wit's end. I had lost some weight, but I knew I needed to lose more. And I just didn't know what direction to be going. And I was on my way home one day and I said, God, I need you to show me where I need to be going with this weight loss. What do I need to do? What is the right program? And I felt him saying to me, why don't you incorporate a new career along with that? And I was like, okay, what could I do? So I'm thinking maybe a nutritionist, because I didn't want to. A dietitian has to go to do some more medical training, more than a nutritionist does. So I thought, okay, maybe I could do a nutritionist. So I went home and I started searching, and up came health coaching. And I had never heard of health coaching before. So I started looking into it, and I just knew that that's where God was leading me. That's where he wanted me to go. So got my health coach certification. And when we're being trained and getting certified, we're also being coached by other coaches. We have coaches that are paid to coach us. And then those of us going through the program coach each other. And so that's when things started to change. And I knew that God had directed me that way. So before you start any weight loss program, I really encourage you to ask God where he would want you to go. I mean, I pray that God sends you my way, but my program may not be for everybody. So you need to pray about where he wants you to go. Remember the Lord in everything you do, and he will show you the right way. So everything, think about that too. Everything. It doesn't mean just some of the things. It means everything. He cares about all the areas of our life, even the messes that we've created. I didn't want to ask God for help in losing weight because I felt like it was my own fault that I had gained so much weight because I knew what to eat. I knew that I shouldn't be eating all of the chips and all of the candies and all of the food, right? Like, and overeating, having seconds and thirds when I ate. But, sorry, I lost my track. So I was afraid to go and ask God for help because I created that mess. But I finally just got to a point where I was like, I don't know where else to go. God, please help me. He's our Father. We are His children. He cares about every area of our life. Hey, Terry. So we need to realize that. Like, if your own kids came to you and said, Mom, I'm desperate. I need your help. I've messed up big time and I need you to help me. Can you please help me? Are you going to tell your kid no? Probably not. You're going to do what you can to help them. Now, I'm not talking about enabling. I'm talking about actually helping them. Hey, Jenny. All right. So God cares about everything and He wants to help you out of that mess. Whether you've created it or not, He wants to help you. John 15 verse 5 says, I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. So abide in Him. And one of my programs, my group coaching program, is actually called Abide. Because, it's gone out of my head. But abide means to endure, like to not give up, to keep showing up, okay? So abide, to remain with God. But then it says, He will, in us, He will produce much fruit. So yesterday we talked about the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, goodness, self-control. So if we abide, if we remain in God, then He's going to produce much fruit. The fruit of the Spirit being self-control. So therefore, if we're abiding in God, He's going to give us the self-control that we need to overcome the overeating. But we need to ask. We need to ask. Psalm 55 verse 17 says, morning, noon, and night, I cry out in my distress, and the Lord hears my voice. And another version says that morning, noon, and night, I'm moaning and groaning. So talk to Him. Like, He wants to hear it. You can cry out to Him. You can moan and groan. You can complain all you want. God wants to hear from you. He wants you to ask for help. He wants you to talk to Him, to have a conversation with Him. It doesn't have to be formal. You don't have to get down on your knees. You don't have to bow your head and cross your hands and close your eyes. Like, you can talk to God all day long and He will hear you. And when you reach out to Him, He's going to answer your prayers. Philippians 4 verse 6 says, don't worry about anything, but in all your prayers, ask God for what you need, always asking with a thankful heart. Verse 7 says, then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. He will guard your hearts and minds. So much there. First off, He's saying, stop worrying. Stop worrying about everything. Worrying is not helping you. Worrying doesn't get you closer to your goal. Worrying actually adds more stress, which increases your cortisol, which then puts you in the fight or flight mode and then shuts down your digestion. So stop worrying. Instead, go to God with everything, for everything that you need, always asking with a thankful heart. When you do that, then you're going to experience God's peace. And God's peace is beyond understanding. Like, the peace that passes all understanding. If you felt that, You know what I'm saying. You know what I'm talking about. It's just like, you know that you should be stressed out, but for some reason, you just have a peace about you. And he will guard your hearts and minds. So he's going to guard your heart, that emotion that you're feeling. He's going to guard that. And he's going to guard your mind when you start making excuses and saying, yeah, but it's comfort food. Yeah, but I need to have this. I can't control myself. I'm a loser. I'm fat. I'm never going to succeed. All of those things, God can guard that. So don't worry. Pray. Tell him what's on your mind. Thank him for what he's doing in your life. And he's going to give you the peace that passes all understanding. And he will guard your heart and mind. Psalm 139, verses 23 and 24. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. Point out anything that offends you and lead me along the path of everlasting life. So first off, search me, O God, and know my heart. This is the thing. Sometimes we are afraid to go to God and tell him what's really on our mind, because we don't feel like it's okay to be mad at God, or that, well, I really shouldn't go to him about that. You know what? He knows our heart. So whether we verbalize it to him or not, he knows what we're thinking. Like, we can't hide from God. So you might as well just tell him what's on your heart. But here's the other thing too. Tomorrow we're going to be talking about our heart's desire. And what I love is that the closer you get to God, then the more your heart's desire becomes what God's heart's desire is for you. So get him to search your heart and to see where it is you want to be, or to see, okay, see if there's any wicked way in me. Test and know my anxious thoughts. So he's going to work on our heart. He's going to see what's deep down inside. And then he's going to be able to work on that, because now we've asked for his help. Point out anything that offends you. So again, going to God and saying, all right, you know my heart. You know where I'm at. You know where I'm struggling. God, I need you to show me what I need to be changing. What do I need to do differently? And like I said, for me, he led me to health coaching. Where is he going to lead you? I don't know. It's different for everybody. But I encourage you to ask him where he's going to lead you. And then lead me along the path of everlasting life. Or lead me along the path of everlasting weight loss. Like, the whole premise of my program is that you can change your mind, change your mindset, change the way you think, transform your mind so that you don't ever have to diet again. So that you don't even have to diet this time. This time, you're going to be able to eat the foods that you love, and you're going to be able to eat them in moderation. We get the cravings under control, the binging, because we work on the mindset. And we do that inner work. We work on putting God at the center. And then the other stuff starts to fall into place. And you can lose weight. I lost 86 pounds without dieting. 86 pounds by eating the foods that I love, but learning to eat them in moderation. And the more I did the mindset work, the less I wanted to eat the crappy food. Be content. This is 1 Peter 5:6-11. Well, I don't think it's 6-11, but maybe it's 6 and 7. Be content with who you are and don't put on airs. So first, we'll stop at that. Be content with who you are. Where you are right now, don't loathe yourself. Stop the self-loathing. You are exactly where you need to be right now, and God can work on that. So be content with the place you're at. I still have 110 pounds to lose. I could be all up in my head being upset over the fact that I have so much weight left to lose, and I've already lost over 80 pounds. But instead, I'm learning to be content with where I am. God has brought me to this place at this time for a reason. Part of it is because the girls that I work with, they are like, I had somebody say, Kim, please don't lose weight too fast. I love that you're on the journey with us and I love that you understand. And she said, I'm afraid that if you reach your goal, you're going to forget what it's like to be here. Now, obviously, she doesn't want me to stay overweight. She was saying it kind of tongue in cheek, but I do understand where you're at. And I wouldn't be able to do that if I wasn't content with where I'm at now and learning how to show up every day and how to coach you guys and being able to understand where you're coming from. And then don't put on airs. Oh my goodness. Don't hide. Oh my goodness. When the girls don't show up, either they don't show up on their call or those in the membership that aren't checking in with me, because they can check in with me multiple times throughout the day, at least once a day. And so when I haven't heard from them in a couple days, I know that they're hiding. They are pretending that everything is okay because they don't want me to know that they're struggling. The problem is, how can I coach you through the problems if you're not telling me that you have problems? So, and then I'll reach out to them and I'll say, all right, you're hiding. What's going on? Give me the details. Don't put on airs. Let me know what's really going on. And then the next part of the verse says, God's strong hand is on you. So, I mean, it's not as his strong hand is on you like an oppressive strong hand, but his hand is strong. God can withstand anything. We can't, but he can. So we need to lean on that and we need to allow him to guide us. Live carefree before God. Can you imagine the feeling of the freedom and being able to live a carefree life, not having to worry about your weight and everything, like what you eat all the time? How amazing would that feel? Like, you see people that don't struggle with their weight, or you think they don't, and they seem to have a carefree life. That's what we crave, right? That's really what we want, is that freedom and that carefree life. But we can live that with God. And then the last part of that verse says, he is most careful with you. So he has the strong hand on one side, but he's most careful with you. Think of a newborn baby and how careful and gentle you are with that baby. And that's the way God the Father is with us. He's careful with us. He knows the pain and the emotion that we're struggling with. And he's not going to stomp on us. He's not going to hurt us. God cares for us and he's careful with us. Shirley says, I love the carefree life. Yeah, she's worked with me and worked on her mindset with me. And just last month, she said, I think I'm done. I want to see how I can do on my own, because Shirley's at her goal weight or very, very close. So it's amazing what happens when you can change your mindset. 1 Peter 2:1-3. Clean house. Make a clean sweep of malice and pretense, envy, and hurtful talk. So that negative talk that we keep telling ourselves, again, I'm going back to that. It's all about mindset. This verse says, get rid of it. Let it go. You've had a taste of God, right? So like newborn babies, always thirst for spiritual milk. So stop trying to fill that void. Again, as I said a few minutes ago, stop trying to fill the void with food. Instead, thirst for spiritual milk. Drink deep of God's pure kindness. Then you'll grow up mature and whole in God. When you can become fulfilled in God, the rest of the things are going to fall into place. I have been struggling with that over the last few months, and I had kind of fallen away from doing my devotions every day, from reaching out to God and asking Him to guide me. Even in my program, I had said, yeah, I want it to be a Christian program. And then I went, okay, but I want to include some other people. And so then I kind of pulled back a little bit. And now I've come back full circle and gone, no, God is leading me to do a Christian program. So I need to step into that and walk through that door that He's leading for me to do a Christian program. The other girls, they're welcome to come into the Christian program, but they know they're going to get Christian content. And if they don't feel comfortable with that, there are so many other health coaches out there. I need to step into where God is leading me. And when I can do that, then my life becomes more fulfilled because now I'm doing what God has asked me to do. So that's all I have for today. If you have any questions, please let me know. And I will either answer them now or I will answer them later on as you leave the comments in. If you're watching the replay, ask the questions and I'll come back and answer them. Again, I want to encourage you, if weight loss is something that's important to you, that it is like an 8 out of 10, 9 out of 10, 10 out of 10 for you to be able to get to your goal weight. If you've tried other programs and they worked for a little while and then you fell off track again, if you've been a yo-yo dieter for years and years, then I encourage you to reach out to me and I encourage you to join the membership. And if you're not sure about joining the membership and you want to just get a taste for what it's like to work with me, then I do have the Reactivate email challenge. And so it's 21 days, it's an email program, and you will just get an email every day with kind of like a teaching and an affirmation, a motivation, and a journal. But the membership is one-on-one coaching. So you get to reach out to me on a daily basis or as often as you need. You can text me, you can send me a message in Messenger, you can email me. I have a client who uses Voxer, and so she sends me audio messages. I have another client who uses Marco Polo, which is video messages. Like, whatever works best for you, I'm there for you. I want this to be a program that you love and that's going to work for you. So you get that one-on-one coaching every day where you can check in, tell me how your day's going, what's gone well, what you're struggling with, what do you need help with, what are your goals, and you check in with me every day. But then on top of that, twice a week, I will upload a teaching video similar to this, only like a lot shorter. 5 to 8 minutes. There's a couple that are 10 minutes, but 5 to 8 minutes. And then you'll get a verse of the day, you'll get journal prompts, a motivation, and an affirmation. All of that is only $47 a month. It is less than a coffee a day. It's less than, you know what, $47 a month could be 6 times at Starbucks. It could be going out for dinner a couple of times or going through the drive-through 4 times, right? So this is something that one of my clients just said to me yesterday, I think it was. And she said, your program is teaching me how to achieve my goal and still enjoy life. I absolutely love that. That's what I want for you. I want you to be able to reach your goal and to still enjoy life. So again, if you're interested in the membership, please reach out to me and let me know. We can get on a call if you have any questions, or you can talk to me in Messenger, whatever it is that you need, please reach out. And I will talk to you tomorrow, where we talk about Heart's Desire.